Right, so my name is Anastasiia and I'm a PhD student in Brenda Andrews Lab. And today I'm going to introduce you our approach, which we call PIFiA. So that's a self-supervised computational workflow for protein functional annotation using single cell imaging data. So let's get started. So the problem we're trying to tackle is how to discover protein functional relationships using solely microscopy data. And the approach we propose is a self-supervised deep learning based method that can extract feature profiles and perform many types of downstream analysis. So we call it PIFiA, standing for protein image-based functional annotation. And also you can see it's very similar to PIFiA, which is an oracle and future teller from ancient Greece. You can see picture on the right. Let me start by introducing the dataset we were using for this approach. So our dataset, we obtained it by crossing RFP nuclear marking and far-red cytosolic cell marker to the open reading frame GFP collection. So this is a large scale collection that contains over 4,000 GFP tagged proteins and captures as much as 71% of yeast proteome. So in our dataset that was imaged by Harsha, a postdoc in our lab, it contains three imaging channels and contains over 10 million single cells. So compared to computer vision datasets, it would be sort of image net scale dataset. And from here, I want to introduce to you the approach we propose. So our approach contains a novel training objective, which is predicting protein ID. So basically, we pass an image through our convolutional neural network, and we try to predict the actual protein from the input image. Compared to many existing approaches, this is not a supervised approach. It's actually a self-supervised approach. And the reason for that is we don't use any sort of manual labels or human annotated labels, but instead, we're relying on the information which is contained in the input image, in this case, protein identity. And after the training is complete, we can use the feature profiles, which we derive from the last hidden layer of our neural network. And turns out that those feature profiles actually contain a great variety of functional information. And we can actually use them for many types of downstream analysis. So in this example, you can see how we can use those feature profiles to construct a global hierarchy map of protein functional organization. And depending on the level of the map at which you can survey it, you can basically uncover different types of protein functional relationships. But of course, you can do many different types of protein analysis. So from here, I want to tell you that PIFiA workflow consists of the self-supervised feature profiles extraction using convolutional neural network and also many different downstream analysis. So in this case, you could also see that we extracted one specific feature profiles from the input image. So we refer to them as single cell feature profiles. But an alternative way is to construct an average feature profile by taking all of the images that belong to that particular protein and then averaging their feature profiles. But before I dive into downstream analysis, I want to show you how PIFiA feature profiles compare to existing approaches, namely supervised deep log, self-supervised paired cell in painting, and also a common feature extraction approach cell profiler. So you can see here, we compared them across four different functional standards, ranging from Go cellular component standard to very in detail protein complex standard. And what we found out is that actually PIFiA features outperform other self-supervised approaches, meaning that PIFiA features contain more functional information across different scales of functional organization that varies self-supervised approaches. Also, it's interesting that PIFiA matches or outperforms performance of supervised deep log, meaning that we don't necessarily need to rely on supervised labels, but we can actually use self-supervised approach. And finally, as I just noted, PIFiA is not biased towards manually annotated labels, yet can contain a variety of functional information. So from here, I want to show you different types of downstream analysis. And the first one is constructing global hierarchy of functional organization using our averaged feature profiles. So on the x-axis, you can see the whole proteome, and we can also map their similarity using this sort of hierarchy. And we can survey it across different levels. So in this picture, we try to cut the global hierarchy at the level which is corresponding to optimal Go cellular component analysis. So at this cut, we obtain 9 different clusters, which are strongly enriched for major cellular components. For example, you can see cluster number one contains nucleus. And then cluster number three, for example, contains a variety of punctate structures. So I want to note that our approach is not guided by any supervised information. We're not using localizations as our training objective. Hence, the clusters that we obtain from this global hierarchy are mainly driven by morphological differences. Like in this case, you can see that Golgi apparatus and endosome were joined in one cluster because they were punctate structures. Or for example, we can see ER cluster, nucleolus cluster, and so on. When we looked at this dendrogram, we also tried to see how the feature profiles would look when projected on two-dimensional space. So we used t-SNE to project our PIFiA feature profiles, and we tried to color our t-SNE. So first we tried to color it using localization annotations, and what we saw strikingly is that despite we did not use any functional information, any type of localization annotation as our training objective, we were able to separate, for example, cytoplasm from nucleus, from ER, and from many different localizations. And what's even more interesting, we tried to look inside those localizations. So for that, we used gene ontology bioprocess standard and tried to map 28 major bioprocesses. And we tried to see what kind of bioprocesses can be separated within one localization. And turns out that protein from different bioprocesses were able to be distinguished using our feature profiles. And what's most interesting is that we could even distinguish bioprocesses within one compartment. Like in this example, we could distinguish bioprocesses from the nucleus. So based on this evidence, we tried to devise our own standard of subcompartmental groups solely driven by PIFiA morphological features. And in this standard, 16 out of 30 obtained subcompartmental groups were enriched for some gene ontology category. And we can see that those groups were driven by some sort of morphological differences, like ER clusters number one and number five looked really different in comparison. However, some clusters were not as different. So if we look at cluster nucleus number four, which corresponds to transcription cluster, and also cluster of nucleus number one, which corresponds to proteasome, images from them looked really similar. So we did a colocalization experiment with Kyle Wang, and we tried to see what is the real difference driving those distinction. And it turned out that for those particular clusters, we could see that proteasomal proteins form some sort of a red ring, like a nuclear periphery signal driving the distinction. And it turns out that this finding was supported by many studies that were showing that proteasomes and the nuclear periphery may act as transcription regulators or to degrade proteins. From this, we tried to jump from average feature profiles into single cell feature profiles. And we constructed this sort of a map of single cell feature profiles, again, colored by localizations. You can see how we can separate different localizations from single cell feature profiles. But our next question was, what is the next level of functional information we can target? So we tried to look at different protein complexes. And what's interesting that using single cell feature profiles, we're also able to visually separate different protein complexes. For example, if we look at this cluster number five corresponding to nucleus, we were able to separate different polymerases and other protein complexes, and similar to many different locations on this global t-SNE. So based on this, we proposed a new clustering approach to discover protein complexes. And the intuition behind this approach is that we can start with a single cell global hierarchy, and we can move down, going from less detailed to more detailed clusters. And we want to stop at the level where we cannot really distinguish proteins. So as an example, on this part of the single cell dendrogram, we were moving down until we ended up with this sort of cluster where all the proteins formed sort of a mix match. And turned out that this cluster corresponded to nuclear pore members. And again, this is illustrated by t-SNEs. On the right, you can see that when we had those three kind of islands, two of them were mostly enriched for one protein, so we were able to separate them out. But once we ended up with this large cluster, all of the proteins looked pretty much identical, driving us to the conclusion that maybe those proteins actually have physical interaction. So based on this approach, morphologically driven clustering approach, as we call it, we try to compare it to many common clustering approaches, including hierarchical clustering, k-means, and dbSCAN across different range of parameters. And we found that our morphologically driven approach outperforms other clustering approaches in many ways. And also we were able to identify 88 clusters that were likely to contain protein complexes, and turned out that 43 of them indeed were enriched for protein complexes. Also, using single cell feature profiles, we were able to distinguish localization heterogeneity. Unfortunately, I don't have time to dive into that, but the whole idea here is that we could look at the distribution of localizations inside one protein, and we can see which proteins were belonging to two or more different localizations. And similarly to that, we could also leverage extra nucleus and cytoplasmic channel to map those localization changes to cell cycle transitions. And our final goal was to explain individual features. So the very simple way we could explain those individual values in the feature profile vector of some protein would be just to train a logistic regression, which would predict localization from the feature profile. So you could imagine that starting with the feature profiles, those individual features which have high coefficients of the logistic regression, they make really large input into some sort of localization category prediction. So we can create this sort of a heat map showing which individual features correspond to which localizations. So that's a quantitative way. But we also had a new way using gradient maps. And this way is basically driven on perturbing individual pixels of the input image and seeing how much the values of the final feature profile change. And in this example, for example, you can see the NUP2 protein, which we used in the beginning, different features corresponded to different input pixel values, like feature number 2 was mostly looking at the top of this ring, while feature number 50 was looking at the whole ring of NUP2 protein. Very interesting example is MCM2 protein, which you cannot really see it here, but actually it has a bright spot over here. And some of the features did not see it, while others like feature number 4, 16, and 20 were able to spot this bright dot. And very, very similar examples across all of the other proteins, we can distinguish different type of morphology using different individual features. And that's like a way in which we can actually distinguish what each individual feature means and what it can see from the input image. So based on that, I want to wrap up with conclusions. So here I presented briefly PIFiA, an automated self-supervised workflow for biological discovery. So PIFiA can distinguish different localization patterns, including localization patterns within compartments. And also PIFiA feature profiles contain functional information that can uncover biology at various levels. And we can use PIFiA feature profiles both as average feature profiles and also as single cell feature profiles. And finally, we introduce two different ways, quantitative and manual, more of like I way of gradient attribution to look what each individual feature of PIFiA means. So based on that, I want to wrap up my presentation, and I want to thank everybody who helped me in this work. A really big thanks to my supervisor. And of course, thanks everybody who listened today, and thanks for coming.